to Freeport. Freeport City Councilman Mario Moreira. And today is the first February meeting for City Council. And so going offline. Okay, now we're back online. Sorry. So I'm going to go over the agenda with you here briefly. I'm trying to get all my connections put in so you can get up close and front. I guess what my thoughts are and just a discussion on the city agenda for tonight. I'm hoping it's pretty informative and we discuss many important topics. So. Going to go over the agenda in a little bit, kind of go over the main points, touch up on it, and go from there. So you remember, if you want to get a better look, we also have the city face streaming or live streaming it on Facebook. But, well, that's just a small view, but the city website has it, so. This is what I see on my end. I think it's gonna be a calm one tonight. But for tonight's meeting, we're gonna talk about. So the first things up is the presentation and announcements, and on presentation and announcements, they're going to talk about the Freeport Police Department. They're going to be speaking about the annual traffic contact report, and that's going to be the police chief. Oh, it's going to be interesting. And with the title of the agenda item is called TCOL Racial Profiling Report. So it's just a report generated by Brass Technology on traffic violations, and it speaks on the demographics, so it's pretty interesting. Location of stops, so 91.26%, it's on city streets. So if you're speeding on city streets, be careful, because that's 90% of the stops by the police officers. 0.27% is on county roads, 0.22% is on private property, and then 8.24% on state highways, probably like 288 and Gulf Boulevard. So, was race known prior to the stop? So I guess this according, I don't know what stats they have, but 99.60% is saying that no. These are all the 4,000 stops, 4,000 police stops. So the race and ethnicity of police officers and the individuals that they stopped is 45% white, which is 1,813. Hispanic and Latino are at 36%. 1,444 individuals, and this is a whole year's worth of information from January 1st, 2022 to December 31st, 2022. Black was 16.80%, 673 individuals of African American descent, Asian and Pacific Islander, 56 individuals, Alaska Native American Indian 0.47%, 19 individuals. So that's the amount of individuals that were stopped, 4,005 last year, from January 1st to December 31st. They have gender, they have all kinds of information on the people that they stopped. So like alcohol, I don't know how they generate this. In 2019, they stopped around 5,171 folks. 2,610 individuals. 2022, 4,005 individuals that they stopped. So that's the most was in 2019. Second most was last year of the folks they stopped. It's pretty much the same way. First was to be Caucasian, white, at the most stops for every year, then Hispanic, Latino, then African American, black. Yeah, that's the one, first, second, third. So it's pretty, it's a lot of information. You can check this out on the, yeah, I'm doing good, everyone. It's interesting, council meeting. I'm hoping it's nothing that I see controversial tonight. Just a lot of agenda items, but right now I'm just going over the main points. Then from there we have consent agenda, approval of city council minutes from the last time, and then election services. So we're going to be amending it. And from there we go to regular session, council business. And we're pretty much calling the election for Ward A and C, calling the charter amendments election, so that'll be this year coming up. It's gonna be us in the election, and then it's gonna be a bunch of amendments to the charter. And then from there, we're gonna be reaffirming the ethics ordinance, amendment number 1, freeze and Nichols task authorization, set number 17 for sanitary sewer lift station 3, 4, and 14. So we're gonna rehab three sewer lift stations, 3, 4, and 14. Then from there, we have a phase project 1, copper and lead. Authorize freeze and Nichols to to look that up. Then we're gonna be supporting the state GLO funding for levy improvements. And then going to be approving possible approval of resolution 2023-2780 for vehicle and equipment repair maintenance policy, pretty much policy on maintenance. Then you go into the executive session. We're going to go to a workshop before that, then executive session, and then from there it's East End. Executive session is things that we talk between council and the attorney and the city manager. Is allowed, and everyone from the room is basically outside, and what we discuss is the East End. We're still dealing with the East End property swap between BISD for Roy Fleming property and River property used for high school ball diamonds. So East End, BISD, consultation with attorney, potential litigation. Right now that's, I can't tell you what it is, but it's something with the, it has a potential to be a lawsuit or something of that nature with a Viola contract that we have currently. Then you have Motel 6. There's issues there. Investigation of Boys and Girls Club. We got councilmen on there. Then we have Economic Development Project. Bluebird. That's discussing closed session, executive session. And it's all under the governmental code, chapter 551, section 551.071. And we'll take any action after that. We'll come out of executive and then take any action that we need to. But how's it going? Good, good. And pretty much that'll end the meeting tonight. So that's pretty much it. For the meeting in regards to that, but I do want to just kind of go over things. Contract services, make amendments to it, calling the election for May 6th between Ward A and C. They accidentally put mayor there on the notes. And we have all these charter amendments. Charter amendment is so we have a charter and it's basically like the constitution for the city of Freeport, and we have a lot of things that they want to correct that they haven't corrected in past years. Like the first charter amendment that's going to be in the election would be correct spelling and grammar punctuation errors in the charter. So that's going to be there, so people will decide on election day yes or no. Filling in vacancies for city council. How's it going, Mr. Kane?
Yes, sir.
We have that. Update references to current state law. And it's 16 charter amendments that the citizens of Freeport will be voting for. And so charter committee is the one that decides that. They'll get with the attorney, the city manager, and they'll discuss what topics they want to add, you know, what they want to consider as changing or adding or looking at. And so, yeah, that's the charter amendments that we'll be discussing tonight. And then another thing that's going to be, so we got elections between Ward A and C. We have the charter amendments, and then they want to have the citizens vote on a reassignment of some parkland between the BISD, baseball and softball diamonds, and swap it for the Oi Fleming, which would include park developments in the exchange. So they want to send that to the voters to approve. So you'll be voting on maybe in this election, an election, Ward A and C, charter amendments, and the reassigning of land from Oi Fleming to a BISD for park improvements. It could be turned into a park, the whole thing over there by Oi Fleming. But we gotta see. We gotta wait and see. It's pretty interesting. And I'm not sure. We'll have to. We'll be discussing it and see where we go from here. Got about 10 minutes before the council meeting. And we have the city ethics policy that they're trying to reaffirm towards us, council members. So, yeah, the city pretty much is encouraging ethical conduct for city employees and city officials. Encourage public service within the city. Establish ethical conduct for city officials and employees. Require disclosure by city officials and employees of their economic interests that may conflict with the interest of the city. And then number 5 is to serve as a basis for disciplining those who fail to abide by its terms. And the 6th that they're trying to adopt is adopting the ordinance. And the very important purpose of readopting the ordinance to continue to build efforts between the council administration to rebuild and reinforce public trust. So, that's what they want to do with this ethics ordinance tonight. Then we want to authorize Freeze and Nichols for engineering services to lift stations 3, 4, and 14. That's to basically to fix 3, 4, and 14, the lift stations. We have a construction contract that was awarded to CFG Industries last year, and I guess that's where we're going. Cost of the amendment is going to be $35,833, so that's how much. Oh boy. Aquí estoy repasando el agenda de la ciudad. Vamos a comprar unas pompas de agua. Van a subir el agua para las estaciones que tenemos para que lo limpien. It's almost the start of the meeting, everyone. The last thing is, the next thing is, so we're going to be supporting for state of Texas funding a proposed levy and drainage improvements intended to protect Brazosport residents and businesses from devastating impacts of hurricanes. Saludos. And, we're gonna be be a bond in this regards for the levy improvements. Oh, there's a lot of problems in that agenda item number 10. Keep an eye out on that one. Agenda item 11, simple. It's adopting a resolution to approve policy and procedures for repairs and maintenance of vehicles and equipment. I guess this is a policy to get towards the city to make sure that they keep all the vehicles and equipment in good, safe working condition. So the grants require that from the city to keep, to have an ordinance that tells the city to fix, make sure that they're keeping up with the repairs and maintenance of vehicles and equipment. And we go into workshops from there. Oh, it's pretty, I think it's gonna be a pretty interesting meeting. We're almost towards the beginning of it. So, we'll get some little notes, paper. Aquí está, se pone duro, pero no hay otra más que echarle ganas. February, that's fine. We're about this roller coaster rolling here in a little bit. Oh, same old, same old. Freeport, y'all need to get involved more. Need to get more involved. My hair is going out. Oh. We got a lot of folks tonight. So I'm going to show y'all. Council. Got a few folks tonight. A few folks. Yeah. Hopefully it don't get cold this week. Hopefully. Or rainy. I don't know. We'll see. But I'm thinking we're gonna have a good meeting tonight. What else I can do. Got a Mardi Gras February 18th, here about 2 weeks. Next week, I think. Gumbo cook-off, live music, parade at 12, Freeport EDC. We're partnering up with them on the Main Street. We have the daddy-daughter dance. We're about to get the meeting started.
I made a report 3 weeks ago because I had chlorine smell chloride smell outside my house in the neighborhood. And I made a call to the police department. They followed me to the sheriff's department. The sheriff's department told me to tell the police department officer over and do a outside assessment. Well, called the police department back to call the fire department. The fire department never showed up, period. So I called the fire chief, and I asked him, can you look into it? He said he was going to look into it, then they was going to write a report. I never received a report from the fire department concerning the chlorine leak at all, period. I'm kind of concerned about that, because if you're going to look out for the safety of the residents when we have a leak or any kind of environmental disaster, and you can't get transparency in it for the truth, then we are not safe at all, period. That brings me to the LNG restarting. How can we say it's really safe to start it when we can't trust our own EMS system to make sure that they do the right thing? So I'm still waiting on that report. I'm also waiting on the report concerning Jody Bivens being shot in the face with a BB gun, and he got arrested and thrown in jail. And I received the reports from the district attorney's office right along with the other lawyer. And the city dropped the ball. EMS dropped the ball, and the city police department dropped the ball by arresting a man for being shot in his face. And it's a black man. So I'm kind of concerned about that, because I watched them honor the officer here at the last council meeting. A citizen got stabbed in the neck, and I'm glad she did that. But a black citizen got shot in the face, and they throw him in jail based on his past history. That's not right. Anybody would do a gun crime, I don't care if it's a pellet gun, BB gun, it's still a gun crime. It's supposed to be investigated as a gun crime. So do we have the right investigative team or the right policing for black Americans in the city of Freeport? And I'm kind of concerned about that, so thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mrs. Clark?
Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
I'm a clerk, a boiling selfish. My concern goes along a little bit with Mr. Rollerson. We come before you many times, month after month, requesting information, giving concerns that we have. And I honestly never hear back from anyone on anything, on the water leaks, on the drainage, on any of these things. And that's a concern that I have that people truly need to, of the city and of your stature. I send emails, and sometimes I'll get a response, sometimes I won't. But we're not just to be ignored. The people are not to be ignored. And I would appreciate it on the concerns if someone would at least get back with us. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Sam Reno. Oh, I'm sorry. Sam, did you want to talk in general, or do you want to talk about item number 5?
Item number 5.
Thank you, sir. Sorry about that. Ms. Cynthia Stewart.
Did you say Cynthia Stewart?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry.
No, you're fine. I apologize. I already got a lack of hearing. I'm still being done. But I'm not contagious.
I'm kind of stuffy, yeah. So I'm apologizing for being too.
Yes, ma'am.
But I guess God woke me up last night because of what these two were saying. But there's a lot of bad going on here. I have never come up here to speak, my mother has, but I'm just going to read what I wrote. My family and I have lived in Freeport for over 40 years. My mother and I started coming to these city meetings because we love Freeport and have been concerned about things going on for quite some time. However, we quit coming because of the attitude and narcissistic behavior that comes from the leadership that's sitting in before us. Do you know how embarrassing it is to read in the paper what's going on between people who are supposed to be cleaning up and helping the citizens of Freeport? When it comes to politics, your feelings don't matter. Feelings and politics, two separate things. I can tell you from a citizen's point of view, I don't care where your future political endeavors are. I only care about what you do legally for my neighborhood and my city. As a citizen, I only get a few minutes to speak, unlike some that sit in front of us. For each of you council members, have you ever at any time, day or night, driven each block or alley of your ward? Have you ever chosen a house or two to knock on the door and ask the homeowner what you, as a representative of that ward, can do to try to help improve that block? One block at a time, one or two houses at a time. You ran and were voted for each ward to help clean up and make things better. And yet I can name multiple things on my block alone that has never been dealt with or asked about. The city wants us to report things that are broken or illegal, and yet when we do, nothing gets done, as was stated. I can go on and on for hours, but you know what? It won't make a difference, and I only get 4 minutes. If the problem is not on one of the main roads, or if the issue isn't where a city official lives, then no concern. We see it all the time. What are the rules for people who rent out houses? My neighbor has been an issue for the last 9 months. He has been told by Mr. Bob to clean up all the clutter twice, now or else, yet he still has tons of junk there. He has added illegal building to this rent house that has become a halfway house with addicts living there. He has chickens and roosters that are roaming into my property, tearing up my grass and crapping on my driveway. Thank God it's not 100 degrees yet. Can you imagine what that smells like? I've called the cops multiple times, and yet he's allowed to continue to do this. The city official is not getting his job done, and yet he's still allowed to have a job. Don't understand, if I don't do my job and work, I'm gonna get fired. Easy as that. Either you need to get him help or replace him. You guys talk about making our city beautiful. That's the biggest joke yet, and very sad. The only time a city official wants to talk about growth is either they're going to get a kickback or it's going to infringe on their property. Normally, when there's a rumor, there's some truth to it. Does anyone on this panel want to discuss about taking people's property up to the railroad tracks in the next 10 to 20 years and then move forward to Glasgow Boulevard after that? Talk to the citizens about those phases. Remember, transparency, everything has to be transparent because it's getting ridiculous. There are a lot of concerned home-owning citizens in Freeport, but it seems no one that works for the city that has the power truly cares. The city of Freeport is an amazing place and has an immense amount of potential, but unless those that have any say-so, what comes into Freeport or what gets done in Freeport doesn't get a kickback, Freeport will always be in the same shape it's in. Not much has changed. We've been here a very long time. For example, the boardwalk. Could you imagine what it would be like right now? Another grocery store. Nobody wants to know the story of that. And I agree with you, Mr. Pena. We don't need another dollar store here in Freeport. We have three already.
Thank you, ma'am. Four minutes up.
I figured that.
Then the rules.
Yeah. How come everybody else doesn't follow them?
Okay. Now, Ms. Madam Morris.
Good evening, Mayor and City Council members.
Good evening.
My name is George Madam Morris, and I reside on North Avenue. I have a statement on the actions from last council meeting. I have concerns about a council member from Ward 8 and his disclosure on a memo from the executive session pertaining to EDC Project Bluebird. Yesterday, February 5th, 2023, on his personal social media account, he released info on the discussion that is to be considered confidential and could be detrimental to the negotiations of this deal. He has previously proven that he has disregard for executive session discussions by disclosing other info from previous meetings. He has also stated that he has conversed with the city attorney who stated that this is permissible, which I seriously doubt and would like clarification from the city attorney himself. With this repeatedly happening, I ask that he be excluded from all executive sessions if he does not immediately resign because of these transgressions, so as he does not do further harm to the city. I also ask that the city, as the district attorney, for criminal charges of a Class B misdemeanor being brought against him for this most recent violation. Thank you for listening to my concerns, and I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Betty, are there any other documents or forms for assistant counsel? Mrs. Dancy, if you want to speak on 6 and 10?
Yes, sir.
Where did you go? Okay, thank you, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. With that, we'll go into presentation announcements number one, presentation of the Freeport Police Department's annual traffic contact report for 2022. Chief Powell.
Also, Mr. Mayor, as Chief Powell comes up here, she has a couple of introductions she'd like to make to the council and the public.
Good evening, Mayor, Council.
Good evening.
I have two of our new officers that have recently joined us. I wanted to take the opportunity to be able to introduce them to everyone.
Please.
The first officer and everything is Officer Joaquin Torres. And Officer Torres. Officer Torres was actually previously with Freeport Police Department for not quite 2 years. I think the grass was going to be a little greener on the other side, but I think he got a little homesick and decided to come back to us, so we were super excited when he had conversations with us to come back. So he has a 2 years of experience, the majority of that being in the city of Freeport. He's actually a bred, born, and raised here, Brazoria County Boy, graduated from Angleton. His wife was really supportive and excited for him to come back here as well, and they have four children together. So we're excited to have Officer Torres come back to us. Then we also were very fortunate to get Joey Earl. That is Officer Earl back there. Officer Earl started his law enforcement career in 2013, actually as a dispatcher. Dispatched for a number of years for the Sheriff's Office and then also for West Columbia. Attended here locally at the Police Academy and started at West Columbia as a police officer, worked his way up to corporal, and then transferred over to the Brazoria County Constable's Office. So he's done a range of both criminal and civil, had some admin responsibilities there, but decided to get back into municipal policing. So we were very excited to have the opportunity of someone of his caliber to come here with experience as well. And so he has joined us this last week as well. So I just wanted to
welcome both of y'all.
Part of that is, of course, stating what the law is regarding the Texas Code of Criminal Procedure, Article 2, and Chapter 2, I apologize, in Article 2.131 to 2.138. So that's the reason that we do the annual racial profiling report and submit that to Texas Commission on Law Enforcement, or also referred to as TCOL. Number two, we follow the internal policy of bias-based policing and racial profiling. This is actually a recommended policy to the Texas Police Chiefs Association, part of their best practices accreditation program, which we are an accredited agency. So we follow those recommended guidelines for policy. Attached with the with this memo, I have included the 2022 racial profiling report that is printed direct from our vendor, Brazos Technology, so that way you can see the report in its entirety. And then I also provided some statistical data from 2019 to 2022 for comparison, for you to be able to see over the past few years where we've landed on each of the different categories, the total contacts and percentages for 2019, 2020, 2021, and then our current year that we just submitted, 2022. And then lastly, I have also included some data graphs and everything just to be able to show again some annual comparisons for overall contacts, traffic contacts, and searches.
Chief, I reviewed this and I appreciate your efforts in this, but what I really do like is an annual statistical report, the very strategic meeting from 2019 to present that really still keeps us in perspective, at least for me, in regards to the historical references we have. So thank you for including that.
No, I think it's important to look at the previous 3 years for us to be able to see what pattern everything that we're following. You see a little bit of change just in overall numbers during COVID time when contacts were actually reduced when we had officers not performing as much traffic contacts just because of being more cautious of COVID. But other than that, statistically, the percentages are close to the same.
We will make sure that this is posted on the police department website as well.
Yes, sir.
Council, do you have any questions for Chief? Very good. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
The next item up, ladies and gentlemen, is the consent agenda. In one case, due to items that be considered routine in nature and may be acted upon in one motion. If there's any item requiring additional discussion, may be withdrawn from the consent agenda by the mayor, council member, city manager, and secretary. We have two tonight. One is the consideration for possible action on the approval of city council meeting minutes from January 2023 to 2023. And then item number three is consideration of possible action to amend the approved contract for election services between the city of Freeport and the county clerk of Missouri County to now provide that the presiding judge and alternate presiding judge shall be Jarvis Davis and Clarissa Molina, respectively. Council, is there a motion?
Can you pull up number three, ma'am?
Pardon me?
Can you pull out number three?
All right, we will pull out number three. Is there a motion on item number two?
I make a motion to approve item number two. I can't turn on the speaker for some reason. Okay.
Yes, I got it now. Yeah, I make a motion to approve item number two.
We have a motion to approve item number two. Is there a second?
I'll second.
We have a second from Councilman Kane. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Aye. All opposed? Motion carried unanimously. Thank you. Now in council business regular session, item number three, consideration of possible action to amend the approved contract for election services between the city of Freeport and the county clerk of Missouri County to now provide the presiding judge and office presiding judge shall be Jarvis Davis and Clarissa Molina, respectively. Is there a motion?
I'll make that motion, Rick.
All right. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All right, so we have a motion from Councilman Kane with the second from Councilman Mariah to approve. Discussion, Councilman Pena.
Yes, Mayor, I was curious to learn how the judge and the alternate presiding judge were selected by the city or by the county. Can you help to provide any information on that or our city attorney?
Yes, sir. Either the city attorney or Mr. Skelton. Mr. Skelton?
Yes. So, typically, the city secretary serves in that role. However, the county did select the two names, and based on the circumstances recently in regard to yourself, as well as they thought that she was too close to the. They thought that she was too close to a.
Who's they?
County clerk.
Mr. Kelty, is Mr. Jarvis Davis, is he a city employee?
Yeah, he's not.
He's from the county? Do you happen to know where he's employed?
He works for the county.
Is the mic on? Can you speak in the mic? Or Jeff, would you better use your mic or something? Or no, I think what Ms. Baywell says that he works for the county. Is that
right?
The county of Peoria?
Okay. And this election has to be a Freeport resident, or is it countywide, or how does that work?
She gets Freeport residents, the way I understand.
Okay.
Any further questions, sir?
I have a couple other questions, but I see a couple other hands up. I'm happy to defer to the audience for some.
Well, let's go with your question first.
Sure. Well, I wasn't actually aware of the circumstances that had disqualified Ms. Wells from presiding as the alternative judge. But now, learning that, it reminds me of the unfortunate circumstances of those meetings that we had here last month, where there was letters provided on behalf of city staff, and it was expressed, I think by Ms. Wells and also by Ms. Kathy Gazelle, that there was a sentiment among the City Hall administrative staff, and I'm trying to remember what role Ms. Clarissa Molina holds, if she is under the purview of Ms. Wells and or Mrs. L. And if we need to take that additional consideration to happen. That same reason why the county judge had thought that Ms. Wells would not be a seemingly fair choice, I'm here thinking, well, maybe we're at the same juncture here then with any of the city administrative staff. So my first question is, what is her position? Who she answers to? The second one, if we can create an alternate with a resident here at Freeport that we can all agree on, I'd like to consider that discussion.
And two things. One, I don't think they said that she couldn't be fair or they said that she was too close to her, they say.
I'm sorry.
But two, I'm not sure yet, a council opinion. Quite frankly, of all the years I've been in politics, I don't recall who makes the selection. If it's the county elections office or if it's the city of Freeport, my gut call is it's the county election office and chooses the individuals.
And so, where does that leave us?
With two folks, Calvary Davis and Melissa Molina, part of the motion, I think.
And it can't be altered?
That would be up to the elections department.
Is that something that you can consider here or not?
I don't know the specific answer to that.
Would I try and be able to get something on something?
I'd have to look into the double check that we form a
lot. Sorry, go ahead.
My apologies. I'd have to look into the double check that we form a lot of time budget.
I would like to make sure we have that answer clearly before we move forward. That's all I have, Mayor.
The answer is in regard to the question for title. She is acting as assistant city secretary. She doesn't work to me. She doesn't report to say happy or to
what? What's the individual folks that were chosen by the election board? So we do have, I think, Manny, Ms. Clark, and Sam. Ladies first, Ms. Clark. And I put it down on number three.
After discussion with the elections office, these people are actually appointed by your Republican and Democratic Party. That would be for Republican Shane Green and for Democrat Chris McGarve. Deanna Cardozo will actually be in the library to be the judge there. Jarvis Davis will be at the county location.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Serena?
Mayor, Council, if I recall correctly, it was the county election director that was would appoint the Freeport residents to be on the judges here in Freeport. And the one that was conducting the violations at the poll was Mr. Russell, the candidate for 14, he was the one that was in the complaints, filed on the voting field report. They would call him and he would come out here and collect whatever. But they used to be that the candidate was selected to. In fact, I don't know how that's written. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Manny?
There are election rules that we all have to follow, and they have it in the packet. This is why it's so concerning about who's going to be the election judge. Because to me, anybody that works for the city of Freeport is a conflict of interest. I'm going to just say that flat out, because we have an issue in our city government. But to tell candidates they can't put signs on their street, that is wrong. That is wrong.
Thank you, sir.
We got one more question. The audience.
Hold on 1 second, please. Hold on, we're going to have a question. Miss Nancy, please. I'll put it down at number three. Hold on 1 second. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Camp Nancy, 313 South Front Street. It just seems to me that, not me, but the city is creating this conflict because of the conflict that's been going on last year and so forth, which is a shame. But anyway, I have nothing against the alternate judge. It just seems to me that you guys would make sure that it was not somebody with the city, so that we wouldn't be up here debating this or saying something about it. It just seems to me that, you know, good grief, couldn't you have asked Angleton, please don't let it be a city employee, because otherwise we're going to have conflict at city council meeting. Thank you. And nothing against Ms. Marissa whatsoever.
Ms. Mangors.
George Mangors, 1722 North Avenue. I'm just going to come up here and make a statement on the integrity of Ms. Marissa Molina. My limited interactions with her, she's been well aboard. Everything that she has, I've asked a question of, she's been able to do. She's trustworthy, and this is my personal opinion. I don't see a reason why you can't trust her to be an alternate judge. It's not like she's going to be any votes or anything like that. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, so what is the role of a presiding judge and an alternate judge for
what
this?
What do you think the role is?
Well, I mean, because I know Ms. Diana Cordova, she will be, I guess, the main judge there, and she would be, I'm assuming, counting the votes from each machine. I'm not sure, I'm guessing she would have an assistant to help her gather the results, and then they'd tally them up, put them in an envelope, and take them. I'm not sure. I guess Mr. Jarvis would be at the Angleton location. Would they be doing the same, or would they be? Because I know at the county level, it takes a different when they take the envelopes, they take them to the county. They give them to the county employees, and I know some folks go over the provisional ballots, some folks go over the results. What is their roles there in the county level?
Well, the boxes, last time I voted, and I'm not a big fan of machines, but last time you put your ballot in the machine, it picks it out. You give it to somebody this last time. You gave it to somebody at the door, they put it in the lock box. The lock box, when the polls are closed, are secured and driven up to the city of Angleton, or the county seats, usually in Angleton. And then the election folks will proceed with the job they're tasked to do. And I understand the presiding judge is basically the representative of the city of Freeport and is there for the process. But more specific than that, I don't know. But I do agree with Ms. Clark. Where'd you go, Carla? I do agree. I've forgotten. You think I wouldn't forget, but the party chairs select judges from each party.
And just for clarification, there is only one voting location for this special election. That is in the Freeport. They don't have a voting location in the county. There are four other individuals involved with compensation matter, an alternate compensation manager, tabulation supervisor, and an alternate tabulation supervisor. They're also appointed by the county. Traditionally, I know that it was mentioned that we shouldn't appoint a city staff person, but traditionally, as long as I have known in every city, the city secretary acts in that capacity. It's just in this particular case that they made a change.
Good discussion. Any further questions?
So I guess from my, I understand Miss Clarissa. She's very good at what she's done, and I get Mr. Matamor's viewpoint. But I do have concerns with everything that has been going on with city council and city staff. I share the same feelings as Mr. Councilman Pena. I feel like there is a conflict. And so I do think we should see what other avenue we can take for this specific agenda item.
So you understand that they don't touch the documents here, or the ballots here, their electronic recorded, they're put in the box, they're taken up, not opened until they get in front of the election officials in Missouri County. But what you're saying is that you don't think Clarissa can do that job.
Well, if that's all she's doing, that's just looking over, making sure the results are put in an envelope, then I'm fine with that. That's what they're doing, Mayor.
It's my understanding. If you call the election clerk and ask them, you have this agenda item, and you spoke to the election clerk.
No, sir. But I was just trying to see if I could get a clear answer here in council.
No, I understand. I appreciate
the attorney here tonight.
Okay. Any further questions? Yes, sir. You have a comment? Need to make it go on. There you
go. Yes, sir. I have a question. Yes.
Hold on a second, please.
That's the nature of the nature of the job in terms of the voting aspect.
Administrative. What is administrative mean, sir?
It's collecting boxes, driving to the location. It's a chain of custody.
Do they manually tabulate the results, or is that just the machine does everything?
No, I mean, unless there's different processes in this county, I'm not familiar with that. No, it's all machine processes.
Okay.
Ms. Nancy, do you have another comment on this matter? Is that this is something that's done every year when we have elections. And it's generally two city folks, and it has been Betty Wells. This is not something this council decides. This is something that the autocrats within the parties and the autocrats in Missouri County and the elections department do. I don't know why we're having this issue unless you've done your homework. That's all I'm asking. Ms. Clark, you've done some homework. And I'm assuming we want an election.
Definitely. Carter Park, 4-7. Actually, after doing my homework, the Ms. Clarissa would only be the third one down the chain. Okay, so it's going to be Ms. Deanna at the location in the library, Mr. Jarvis at the county elections, and then if Ms. Deanna is not able or Mr. Jarvis is not able, then Ms. Clarissa would be. So, you know, if you want to point someone else, that's fine, but it's a chain, so I don't know that it's going to be a problem.
Thank you.
You see, that's a good answer right there.
So, we'll see if we change your mind. All those in favor of item number 3, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carried. Council Benny, I didn't hear you. Did you vote out? Thank you, sir. Now, motion carried unanimously. Thank you. Item number 4, consideration of possible action approving the ordinance number 2023-2686, calling the general election on May 6, 2023 for the election of council positions for wards A and C. Mr. Kelly.
Yes, this is the ordinance that Ms. Rolson prepared calling the election for Ward A and C.
All right, Council, is there a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve item number four.
We have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, sir. Any discussion on item number four?
Yeah, got some mayor. You gonna resign today?
Yeah, wait.
I'm number four. You know what? You sure did. Sorry about that. Hold on. We're gonna get along real quick.
A little bit, Clark.
You have votes for Clark, of course. It's right there, election.
Short and sweet, Carter Clark, for living selfish. My comment was, Mayor, I didn't know you were running this election. But the ordinance is correct. It's just the errors in Mr. Kelty's documents that was sent out. It does include the mayor's running this year, so not to make your.
Thank you.
I thought you were going to resign today or something.
You know, I never get it. Let's see, 26 months. Thank you, ma'am. All right, so with that, any further comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed, motion carried 4-0. Thank you. So we can do things in the industry. Put that in the paper. Number five, consideration of possible action approving orders number 2023-2687, calling the charter amendment election. Second time on the phone. Let's be careful, folks. So, what we have, let's go ahead and see if there's a motion first, and then we'll go through discussion. Is there a motion on item number five to approve, the charter amendments that have been proposed under ordinance number 2023-2687?
I'll make that motion, Mayor.
We have a motion from Councilman Kane. Is there a second? I will second it, thank you. So now it's open for discussion. First, before we get into discussion, I want to thank each member of the Charter Review Committee. It's not sexy, it's not fun, it's a lot of work, and there's a lot of burdens that you have to go through. So I appreciate the folks that participated in it. I know that y'all all worked hard and come up with this, and I also appreciate Olson and Olson for preparing these particular amendments. Let's see here.
I was gonna say you beat me to the second, Mayor.
Pardon me?
You beat me to the second. I was trying to get this thing turned on.
Just keep it on. That'd be good. But thank you, sir.
Well.
Let's see. We actually have Mr. Raina wants to speak on item number five, limits, and also I'll point out to ladies and gentlemen that he served on the Charter Review Committee. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mayor. Article 3, Section 301, B and D, term limits. We had discussed this, charter review, and it was recommended that it stays as is, the board of 302. And I asked Attorney Olson if that recommendation would still come in front of the council and let y'all vote whether to put it on the ballot anyway. And he says yes, that it will come up in front of the council. And you are going to vote whether to put it on the ballot, which I think it should be put back on the ballot. There was a lot of people dissatisfied with the last election when it was amended to 3 years instead of two years. And the wording had a lot to do with it. A lot of people didn't realize it. They thought they were voting for no, not 3 years. Instead, they were voting for yes, 3 years. So it's up to the council to vote whether to go ahead and put it on the ballot again and let the citizens decide.
So what, if I understand, Mr. Mayor, what you're asking is you're asking council to consider going back to 2 years versus 3 years.
Yes, sir.
So it would be 3 2-year terms instead of 2 3-year terms.
Yes, sir.
Anything else?
Ms. Melinda is concerned. She is capable and trustworthy. And I don't know who she would be replacing, but the judges always ask, one Hispanic judge was one of Mr. Ramirez. And she was a Hispanic judge, and the reason for that, because there's a lot of Hispanics in the city of Freeport, and a lot of them don't speak English, but they had the card or whatever to let them know who they wanted to vote for. So we do need a Hispanic judge at the library.
Thanks. Okay, counsel, Mr. Arena is specifically referring to Article 3, the governing body is the title, Section 3.01, number selection term, items B and items D. Looking at the proposed charter amendment, this is not, there are some red line items in here, which is more in regards to verbiage or the wording in here versus the actual change. And so Councilman, Mr. Rain is asking Council to consider possible change of the terms that exist at this time to go back to the old time. So I've asked Mr. Kelty, what was the, in regards to Mr. Rain, though, what was the request from the majority of charter review?
The recommendation that did come up in the discussion by the Charter Review Commission, along with other items as well, but that particular ballot initiative was to amend the charter, to change it to read 2-year terms instead of 2-3-year terms, basically reverting it back to the language it had previously. And the Charter Review Committee had quite a bit of discussion about that. I think. Shonda Marshall was on the committee, she's here tonight, as well as Mr. Reyna,
Ms. Barbary,
Ms. Oldham, and Ms. Oldham, and there's one more. Ohana Silvis.
Yes, sir.
And the vote was 3-2 to not present that as one of the charter provisions. There were 16 questions that they were recommending. They are listed in here. We'd like to read through those.
Let's finish this discussion first. Okay. So council, at any time, the council can vote to accept the recommendation as stated in regards to the proposed charter amendments, which are 1-16, or you can vote with a majority to modify and or change. And certainly that's one request. I'll tell you from a personal opinion, I didn't, the charter review committee, when they put this forth, whatever it was, 3 years ago, something like that, I didn't object to it knowing because people said, I think people get to decide. But as a person, I voted against it because I wanted 3 2-year terms, not 2-3-year terms. And I did not win. So that is something we ought to consider. And so what I've had out there to review this as any questions for either Mr. Kelty and or our city attorney representative in regards to items 1-16. And this is part of the discussion with the motion.
There are a couple of comments on this.
Yes, sir. And if you'll give us, if it's general comments, great, but if it's specific, it's
sure. First, I want to thank Mr. Rayner for coming out and expressing or explaining that he actually reached out to the city attorney. I was curious, Mr. Rayner, which attorney you spoke with?
David Olson.
Okay, thank you.
In 4 minutes, he said David Olson.
David, I'm sorry. I missed that. I'll follow the call for you. You can see. And I just kind of leaned in or just really glued into your comment here that what this was before my time and you were on council here and they made this vote. And you mentioned that you like the people to decide. And I also agree with that comment. That said, where I'm going with this is that I'd like to make sure that we make sure that the people do decide. And that means those that are in Ward D get a voice in this. And so I'd like to table this so that after the election of Ward D, that we can actually have the residents of Ward D have their representative be their voice. And I just want to make mention of that. I know there's a motion on the floor, but that's my sentiment here.
Ward D, can you have any suggestions?
I will say that in regard to the following of the general election, there's a window to do that. So if we didn't decide to table it, we would have to wait until next, the next general election would be next year before the place back in the
election. I'm also aware of that. I just, my response to that would be, excuse me, so I don't know if you've been sneezing and coughing outside your window when I pass Broad Street. That's over. No, but seriously, this ordinance here has been in place here for the last 3 or 4 years. We've been able to operate pretty effectively. And so, again, I just like for the people to decide and for Ward D to have a voice, as I've stated on other issues as well.
Thank you. Councilor Pena, real quick, are there any specifics? Each person will actually have a council. Are there any specific issues that y'all have with 1 through 16 that were propounded, approved by majority vote in the charter review? Other than the general statement, of course.
The general statement holds the specifics of that are underlined for that. I'd rather have that discussion when we have a full council.
Thank you, sir. Councilman Chang. Thank you, Councilman.
You know, Mayor, I'm all for letting the citizens decide our fate, whether it's up here or not up here, 2 years or 3 years. I personally am okay with the changes that have been made, and I'm also okay with waiting for a representative for Ward D to discuss this particular item or issue, understanding that it would be next year's May general election that it would be on there. So, as far as I'm concerned, we do what we can with what we have here and then get these guys to get their heads together again for next year, and we'll see if it comes up then.
Okay, thank you, sir. Councilman Ryan.
Yeah, Mr. Conte, you said that there's a window, and I guess that would be, we have to take that vote now, you say, right?
The order has to be called, I believe, by the 17th of February. So it is closing quickly.
Okay. Personally.
And it would be prior, I'm sorry, it would be prior to being able to have a board of representation.
I agree with Councilman Kane and Councilman Pena. Yes, definitely. I think that if we have a ward, a representative in D, that they'd be making that decision for their residents, and also that I personally like the 3 year terms. I know whether I'm elected or not, I think it's beneficial for the next council member, or you know, even for myself. But that said, if we want to elect, we want to wait for Ward D representative to make that call, I believe we should. It's not Michael. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen and council members, I was able to attend some of the meetings, not all of them, but some of the meetings. I know that once again, the folks work hard to go through the charter. It is not an easy project. And I can honestly tell you, they did not look at it from a Ward A, B, C, D issue. They looked at it from the charter as a whole. Those many times before, the charter is our constitution. So, saying that, Mr. Kelty and our city attorney, I'd like to, and I have read these thoroughly, and I'd like to go to page 23, please. in a document that's sent to you under section 11.07, special provisions covering damage suits. Page 23, last paragraph, I think that it needs to be changed. Before the city shall be liable for damage claim or suit for personal injury or damage to property, the person is injured, whose property is damaged, or someone that has in his, that person's behalf is in his, is crossed out that line. I think we ought to put the word on, O-N, to make that flow correctly. Thank you. And then I'd like to reference everybody to page 29. This is the actual language that is going out, if approved, for the election. It's under proposition number 7, chief of police, Mr. Attorney. It says, shall section 402 of the city charter be amended to require the chief of police to establish a place of residency within 30 miles from the city? I understand the intent, that is the language that was used, but when I reference back in the charter itself, under 402, which is on page 10 of the actual charter, subsection A, so it's on page 10, section 4.02A, at the top of the page, page 10. Okay. In the middle of the paragraph in the red, it says within 6 months of his or her appointment, the chief of police shall establish the mayor and maintain the place of residence within 30 miles from the city for the duration of his or her appointment by the city in such capacity. My question is a legal question, and so the legal question is on proposition number 7, page 29, and proposition number 9, page 30, is should that question be expanded to text in place of the balance to the ballot to reference the 6 months and the duration of their tenure with the city. So proposition number 7 relates to 4.02A, and proposition 9 is to 4.0.
City attorney respond to that question. I understand what's intended by the question putting it on the ballot.
It's going out. I want to make sure that does it have to be more specific.
I don't think it necessarily needs to be more specific. I don't think it necessarily needs to be more specific. You could have language to the end, as he says, within
6 months.
6 months.
So that you would add it to the end where? To that question?
Shall say, remember, while the chief of police in such place of residency within 30 miles from the city within 6 months of his or her appointment.
Okay. And then my next request then is proposition number 9. Which references the fire chief, which is 4.08, I believe. And that basically be the same question. As it says in the actual ordinance, red line was within 6 months of the point. All right, so that is something that can be easily fixed with a word by product.
That's right.
Okay. All right. And I think all the specifics that I have. So, understanding, ladies and gentlemen, these are the proposals that were sent to us in the charter review. We can accept and vote. We can proceed back to the board. We can vote. We, meaning your elected representatives, can vote to remove some. But that's the pilot that's before us. And we have a motion to approve, hopefully with those three corrections and or additions. So, is there any further questions before we call the question on the vote?
Mayor, should we amend the motion?
In what way, sir?
To include the changes that you had?
I'll ask Mr. City Attorney on that. Do we have to amend our motion, or can we, through discussion, make that one change on the verbiage and or the language for Proposition 7 process?
Ultimately, as long as everyone's clear on what they're calling on, we got more. But for clarity, you probably got to do it.
All right. So we have the motion. Sponsor of the motion, Councilman Kane, I believe, do you have an amended request?
Mayor, I would like to amend my motion to include the changes that you had addressed.
Thank you very much. Is there a second? I will second it. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Hold on, Mayor, I do have a question. So what, we're voting for the charter. For the charter right now. Is that what we're doing?
We're voting for the amendments that are put forth by the Charter Review Committee that meets back when it was 2 years, every other year. Now since it's 3 years, they have to meet a little bit odd, a little bit differently scheduled, but we meet and we're voting on their proposals they sent to us to determine whether or not we put it on the election on May 6th. So yes, we're voting on the charter amendments presented by the Charter Review Committee that we all appointed.
Is it clear?
No. No, it's clear that the amendments are making, actually Council Kane's changes here, I mean, to his motion. Are those exclusively yours, or are they also including Mr. Ames?
I'm sorry?
Are those changes that Mr. Councilman Kane is requesting to be added or amended, those exclusively the changes that you articulated, or they yours plus Mr. Williams?
The amended motion was for the additional verbiage that I think needed to be put in.
Articulated by exclusively yourself.
Articulated by me reading it and seeing that it had an issue and seeing that it wanted to make more specific approach would be.
But not including Mr. Williams.
However, I'm presenting it to you, and I'm assuming the motion's being presented to you to follow the recommendation of the majority of the Charter Review folks, which I understand is reasonable. So, no, it does not include Mr. Reed's request. However, if you would like to consider that, it's something really important. But right now, we have a motion to approve items 1 through 16.
My position remains the same thing.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Any further questions? And once again, if approved, these items will go out with the changes that they made on the language on the propositions that were put forth and pretty straightforward. And then if approved or not approved by the city, they can take it back, but they wouldn't take it by the citizens. With that,
do we have a second on the amendment?
I thought I seconded.
Yes, sir.
Do we have all those in favor say aye?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
Council video?
Next, sir.
So, 2-2. And it fails. So, do we get some money back from the election department if we don't put so much out on here? Probably not. Okay. Item number 6.
Mayor, I have a question.
Is it related to item 5 or item number 6?
Item 5.
Okay, sir.
Item 5. And the question is, so now that the motion is failed, or the agenda item failed, does it get replaced back into next year or next year's election?
Does it get anything unless there's a council member or the mayor or the city manager for our agenda adoption policy? It is not placed back on there because the charter review folks are not due to meet next year. I don't think they're meeting again for those 2 years. And so all of these things that are important will wait for those 2 years.
I guess, wouldn't it be guess something that we should try is, I guess, entertaining a motion to table this item for the council representative for Ward D to vote on, so we can bring it back on April.
But you understand, Councilman Ryan, I think Mr. Jeff said, we have a deadline of February 17th to vote to approve these, to put these on the election.
Yes, sir.
For May.
Yeah, I understand. I just.
Yes, sir. Therefore, if we don't vote on them, they have to vote for election at all. Now, certainly, they can be brought back up, and you can request a special election, I guess, if you want to. But generally speaking, if we don't pass it tonight, if you vote, if you don't want to pass it, then they have to pass it. Actually, they failed by operation of office. But once again, we'll be waiting for.
Yes, I would like to pass them before the next election. I would want to see if we can I'd make that motion to pass all the charter amendments. And I guess in the meantime.
Mario, I don't understand the motion. Are you asking for it to pass now, or are you asking for it to pass?
Well, you know what? I'll take that back. We'll just, I'll get, or whenever we can, we'll see if we can bring it back in April so we can vote for it. In next year's election.
So it stands at 2-2. We will move on. Item number six.
Hey, Mayor.
Once again, I will thank you. Hold on. We're going out. This is number six. I don't want to talk about it. We've already passed by. I just want to thank the Charter Review for your work. Item number six. Not on item number five. You got something to talk about item number six? You can. Okay. All right. Consideration of possible action approving ordinance 2023-2688, calling a special election to authorize the city of Freeport to transfer its property interest in 1.53 acres to Brazosport Independent School District to allow the district to continue to use the 1.53 acres for softball and baseball purposes, so the district can donate 30.9 acres to the city to develop the park for new recreational in park versus before we have that, we have some proposals. Ms. Clark, item number six.
Yes, sir.
May I, item number six?
Yeah.
Okay, give me a minute. Go ahead, then. Ladies first. Okay, Ms. Dancy, you're next, please.
Carla Clark, Board of Selfish. I know that we have the old FIS football field there, and we have the old baseball softball field, which is used for soccer now. But in this number six here, I want to know what the park, it says, to develop in part for new recreation and park purposes. So what park? Is that the park we're talking about? We're meeting with the other park or away from the
ends. Okay, thank you. We're going to answer that in just a second. Thank you.
Okay.
Ms. Nancy?
If you're going to answer that question, I'll just sit right here. So.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
$200,000 that Jeff Pines had also to do that park behind McDonald's. That's where that sports complex was supposed to be at. But now you're swapping this park that's behind us, all that's park anyway. It was supposed to be swapped anyway without the voters voting on it anyway, because all parks in the state takes that we vote on. By the voters to get rid of parks. That's just plain and simple. So I don't know how the school or the city was able to do this deal without coming to the citizens in the first place and vote on it to remove those parks. That's the law, because we're still fighting about Lincoln Park down there right now, which is in Junction. So my concern, why are we building a park This council sold it off. Only built over there. We never got a house started building on the mud project over here and on Velasco. So you're not building no houses, but you want to build a park. Why build a park when ain't nobody moving in the community? It doesn't make sense.
Thank you, sir.
City gets it, that means the port's not going to get it.
Yeah.
I talked to some school representatives that said, oh, no chance the port's going to get it, but you never know about that kind of thing. Once it's in our hands, like I said, I don't care what you do with it. As far as recreation goes, on the upper end across from where Manning lives, there's like the midget soccer, and there's families up there, there's lots of kids. That particular part of that property gets used regularly by families. And it's really a good thing to just hear laughter and kids playing over there. On the high end of it, where the football stadiums are, and the walking track, not a lot of people, but there's a half a dozen, maybe a dozen people there every day, especially when the weather's nice. And it's 6 o'clock in the morning, people exercising on that track, and again in the evening after the pool's done. So, I mean, if y'all get that and use it for recreation, that's fine. If used for housing, that's fine. Just don't let the port get it and turn it into a trailer park. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, that was all the folks on item number six. So let's proceed with the motion, and then we'll have plenty of discussion. I'm sorry? No, I'll do this. Thank you. It's the possible approval of Ordinance 2023-268 on the special election, as stated earlier. Is there a motion to approve?
Mayor, I'll make that motion.
Is there a second?
No second.
Thank you, Councilman Nye. We have a motion and a second now for discussion. Mr. Governor, in just a second, I'm going to take over, but I'm going to say this real quick. This is a project that we've been working on for a long time. I remember y'all may remember some of y'all were here. Signed a document with the city, agreeing to transfer or swap the properties because our idea was to build a neighborhood on that section of land down there where the old Fleming, and where some of you might remember Freeport Intermediate, and there may even be trees old enough to remember when it was a high school. Well, there you go. See, there you go. It's one of the tips. But so we proceeded with that. And we're happy to do so. However, there was an additional language within it that also said that we had to address certain concerns with the General Land Office as well as the Texas Parks and Wildlife Department in regards to certain grants that may or may not have existed on the property as part of the transfer. Our obligation was to work towards getting that released. We had an individual that we were working with the state of Texas, with the General Land Office, I believe, and that person retired, and we have somebody else, and we're dealing with additional requirements. I can tell you the administration has been working on part of that, and so the intent is to build houses, but there also was an idea, original idea, to park, put some of that as a recreational area, as a park, as an escape park. Volleyball places or soccer, that would be up for consideration to the people. But we have to jump through additional hoops, and that's what we're trying to do. And Mr. Kelty will address that, and then we'll set it all up for discussion. Thank you, Mr. Kelty.
So the land in question, only funding property in the land of the river that currently has a baseball and softball diamond. Obviously, all know that that land was entered into an agreement between the ISD and the city over 20 years ago. Agreement for mutual use so that we can use each other's properties. When the county moved forward, when the IC moved forward and decided to invest millions of dollars in that property, they wanted to actually own the property rather than have it released. work out for us because we were actually looking for additional land as well. So the agreement that the city approved a little over a year ago, year and a half ago, with the ISD, there were a couple of caveats. One was that the city used the property to demolish the building at the Oil Fleming property and utilize that property for residential development. The other caveat was that we removed the encumbrances on the land by the water from restrictions for park use so that the school would have that land unencumbered. There's two actually separate encumbrances for parkland. One Mr. Rollerson mentioned, and that is regarding the need for the voters to vote, take action, to have it removed from park designation. And that's what this proposal is addressing specifically, and that be put before the voters. There's another potential action that can be taken to be able to take that out. It wouldn't need to go to the voters, and that would be through legislative action at the state of Austin. And we're actively pursuing both of those kind of in parallel tracks. So, you know, if this goes on the ballot and it gets approved, then we're good to go in that regard. But there's still the restriction, the encumbrance that is tied to the requirement for with Texas Parks and Wildlife. And they will require the city to find alternate parkland to substitute. We have two options. We can either pay them back the $500,000 in the grant that we received back in 2004, or we can find alternate parkland to supplant the land along the river. And looking at the OA Fleming property, the school is amenable to allowing us to have some park development on that. You know, I think that right now what we're considering is about, that track is 9 blocks in size. It would accommodate, if it were fully developed, a residential, it would accommodate 160 residential properties. If we subdivide off about 2.5 blocks for a soccer complex, we would still need to accommodate about 128 homes on that land for new residential development. Now, if we did that, we would also have to find additional parkland elsewhere. And there are some other options that I will be bringing forward as they develop as part of that second leg. But the issue before you all tonight is an ordinance that was recommended by a city attorney to go ahead and put this before the voters to see if we can't make this happen so that we can actually still maintain a level of park space for the residents of the city, but at the same time have that particular property removed from that abundance.
So the idea, gentlemen and ladies and gentlemen of the audience, is that we agree we need more housing, and so that's what the majority of land would use, but we would also be able to use some of it for an expanded park or recreational facility. There you have it. Any questions, Council? Cynthia, go ahead and get your mom up. Don't you?
I have a question there.
Yeah, I think Ms. Clark, did you have a question? Or we have and ma'am, will you be sure and fill out the form before you come out and talk first, but you'll fill out that form before you leave. I appreciate it.
My name is Bonnie
Zimboy.
I'm at 607 West 7. Is this going to be another apartment complex that's going to be trashy like the rest of them? Now we have to live around that? Or is this going to be little shanties that somebody's going to get rich off of?
Actually, it would be proposed to be developed as single-family residential properties.
Have you been around to see what some of these look like in this town? They're not even taken care of. And you want to build more?
I'm sorry, houses or apartments?
Apartments, housing?
Yeah, so it's not being proposed for housing, or excuse me, for resident or rental unit housing. It is proposed for owner-occupied single-family housing.
Yeah. Are they going to have laws enforced to keep everything clean and neat and picked up? Because it's not happening right now. So I don't know what you can build that will look decent 5-10 years from now, right around Freeport. Nobody's taking care of anything, and nobody's doing anything about it.
The idea would be to, in my mind at least, and I'd love to see it happen while I'm here, but it may not, it may be gone by then, but is for us to build the infrastructure which the roads, the water and sewer and so forth, and then allow local builders, who we've had a number of local builders come in and build some very good houses, single family dwelling, to one, keep the money here, keep the money with the builders and so forth. But if somebody wants to come in and build a house, it's, we're looking for single family houses in a planned neighborhood.
But he's going to watch them to make sure that it's not trash.
Well,
it's not happening.
We have, I'll tell you, historically, ma'am, when the EDC worked with, I can't remember the name, Reality something, World, what was it? Real World. When they started building their houses through a project with the EDC, and they were substandard, we put a stop to it. And we're in the middle of a lawsuit. But we would work with the codes that we have, and we would work with the ordinances that we have once they're built. But the idea is to put a nice neighborhood in there. And then it's up to the individuals to take care of the property, subject to the laws of the city.
But we've been trying to use the code enforcers and other people in our community, and they're not doing anything. So what makes us believe you're going to get farther? I have a neighbor in my neighborhood, he doesn't even have a front yard anymore. It's nothing but trash.
Yeah,
and the inspector has been right there looking at it.
And if that's a 7-Eleven, Cynthia, I think.
No, I have an issue. She has an issue.
Oh, so, well, I want y'all, before you leave, please, to make sure you give us the addresses to Mr. Kelton. Just write them on a piece of paper, use one of the forms, if you like, and we'll take a look at it. But I'll also tell you, and Ms. Roman could probably tell you too, there's probably 15 people who come up and say we're overcoating. So, you know, I can only hope that, well, Alexander Pope said that hope springs eternal, and I happen to believe that. I'm an optimist and believe in a glass is half full. So I hope that we build the houses and good folks will come.
Well, I'm an optimist myself, but I believe optimism also starts with people holding jobs and doing that job, which they're not doing.
Yeah, very good.
So perhaps we need to replace some people so they can do the job.
Okay. But please, Ms. Stewart and Ms. Emily, please give us the addresses that you refer to. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Brooks, there's not going to be any council members doing houses, right?
No, I don't know.
Hard watch for aluminum sailfish. Just a quick question. Those are great aluminum bleachers. Is that field big enough to be like a soccer field within that old football, the old FIS football field? I mean, I don't know how big you have to be. Are you talking about children's soccer or adult soccer or both?
All I can tell you is it's 120 yards long, because I play football, and so it's 10 yards from the end zone, and it's 51 feet yards wide. I don't know if that's enough for soccer or high school.
Those bleachers are nice.
But they are nice.
And then a little baseball field or softball field back behind us, you can use that. But so this is a special election for this mate.
Ma'am?
This is going to be on a special election for this mate?
Yes, ma'am. It's Friday night.
The different things that you were talking about in there, different uses and stuff, we're going to have that on another meeting and still be able to put that on the main agenda?
In regards to usages of what?
The different things that Mr. Kelton said with the parks and wildlife and that.
No, this is just the first. The first step was to sign the agreement, which you did a while back. The second step is to proceed, and either hopefully the citizens will approve this and we can then continue. It'll be set, and the administration is going to continue working with Texas Parks and Wildlife and GLO to get everything done.
This will be this May election.
But yes, this ordinance would call for the election in May, yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Yes, Councilman.
A couple of questions, man.
Yes.
Thanks for your comments on this.
Pardon me?
And thanks everybody for their comments as well. I want to thank everybody for their comments. It's my understanding that we don't need an election to transfer this property. If we can do that through legal formalities, can you help to clarify that, Mr. Donahue?
Yeah, so essentially, I know it's been mentioned by members of the public, section is 253.001 of the local government code. It requires that if you're going to sell a public park, you have to take it. So two options, two tracks to solve that is either have the election as approved by the voters or have the legislature. legislature amend the section to carve out that authority for disuse, which they've done. If you look at that section of the statute, there's a number of carve-outs that they've done. So essentially, that's issue one to be resolved. The second issue is related to grant deferrals.
Is there, I thought there was also discussions previously that between two government entities that you would need to have an election as well, that transfer between properties can be done as well. Have we looked into that as well as the third option?
I'm not familiar with our discussion, but I don't know that option would be there.
I will say this, Councilman. If this is approved and goes forward, there's still time between now and May to discuss a number of things. If that's an option between governmental entities and so forth, and I know there's some discussion prior to this, but this would just set it for our time frame that if it's not a option, that we can proceed and put it in front of the voters and they can determine.
If it becomes an option, how would we act on that? How could you foresee that happening? Would we still just wait on the election, or would we hold a hearing and then just try to?
We can actually, without speaking too much out of terms, we can actually cancel the election if it's the will of the folks, except those that are set by state and the federal government.
Whose will would that be?
Whose will would be yours, Mr. Kane's, Mr. Brown's, Mr. Savannah, and Representative Coordinator.
Got it. All right. And then I'm just also curious, what's TPWD saying, what we can and cannot do? I know there's been a change in the administration offices for TPWD. Can you help to clarify that and expand on that?
Yes, so there, the individual that we were dealing with a year and a half ago, they've been there for a while, and their interpretation of what we were required to do is different than the current administration's interpretation of what is required. They were previously looking at it a lot more loosely, and now they're looking at it a lot more straight.
And there's no rebuttal on our part to say the stricter interpretation is too far and too, maybe a little too difficult, and maybe that there is a more flexible approach to what his or her predecessor might have had.
I know that Mr. Olson and the attorney from the school district have both lobbied pretty hard on a particular issue without success.
Interesting.
But ultimately, it is that official's decision.
Is that official here in our county or in Austin?
In Austin.
Do we know that person's name?
Not right now, but I can be interested.
I'd be interested. Thank you. I have no further questions.
Thank you, Councilman. And I appreciate your comments. And that's, you know, and with Phelps' suspenders here in regards to approving this ordinance and having it there to go in front of the voters, and hopefully we'd all lobby pretty hard to get it passed. But I'm always open to continue to work on other avenues.
Yeah.
So, with that, I will call the question. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. All those opposed, motion carried unanimously. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for your comments, ladies and gentlemen.
Was that another 4-0?
Pardon me?
Was that another 4-0?
That was 4-0. Can't keep it here. Number 7, consideration of possible action, approving resolution number 2023-2778, reaffirming ethics ordinance 2019-2567. This is something that is annual. Mr. Kelly, do you have some comments?
Yes, this is the ethics ordinance that was adopted in 2019, required annual review and action for reaffirmation. The ordinance lays out specific ethical expectations for all individuals involved in Freeport local government, including employees, all appointed board members and committee members, as well as elected officials. The precepts are very common sense in nature, but ensures that everything is well spelled out. Some special considerations are that the ordinance lists the purpose of the policy as follows: to encourage ethical conduct on the part of city officials and employees, to encourage public service within the city, to establish standards for ethical conduct of city officials and employees by defining and prohibiting conduct that is incompatible with the interests of the city, to require disclosure by city officials and employees of their economic interests that may conflict with with interest to the city and to serve as a basis for disciplining those who fail to abide by its terms. And a sixth and very important purpose is of readopting ordinance to continue the effort of this council and administration to rebuild and reinforce public trust. There are no, I did not include any proposed changes to ordinance 2019-2567 as it was considered, debated, and approved in 2019.
So there have been no changes to the resolution since 2019 at all?
To the ordinance. The resolution is just,
excuse me, the ordinance, yeah. I have a couple of questions.
Let's do this real quick. I don't know if I have to do this first. Before we have discussion, let's see if we have a motion to approve or a motion.
I'd like to make a motion, Mayor.
Yes, sir.
To table this and have some further review on it.
Okay.
Discussion on it.
We have a motion to table. Is there a second? May I we'll ask a question, Mr. Attorney. Mr. Kelly, is there a time frame that we have to approve this, sir?
No, sir, this is annually on. And I'm not sure what the individual action is. I
couldn't remember.
Probably thought I can tell you exactly
when it was. It was February 19th, 2019.
So this is the time to adopt it if we were doing.
So if we table it to February 17th, which is, I think, our next week. No. Yes. February who? 21st. February 21st. Thank you. Amen.
I think we would probably be okay to do that.
And I'll second the motion to table.
Appreciate that.
Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Well, it wants this moving to table. So I will ask that it be re-agenda for February 21st.
I agree.
Thank you. But I will remind council and ladies and gentlemen, that we are still bound by the existing ethics code that we had adopted from 2018. So item number 7A, please show a table to reach in for February 21st. Item number 8, consideration of possible action on amendment number 1, DeVries and Nichols task authorization number 17 for sanitary sewer lift station 3, 4, 14 rehabilitation. Mr. Kelly.
Yeah, so this, and Mr. Barber is here from Breeze and Nichols, and Lance may want to comment on this, but this amendment to task authorization number 17 with Breeze and Nichols will allow the provision of additional necessary design services for the rehabilitation of lift stations 3, 4, and 14. And I will say that that project has already been awarded. It has been delayed because of some supply chain issues, but now, as far as I understand, their output has been seized, and they are proceeding. So I'm excited to get this project moving again. But there was additional design necessary. During the design phase, it was recommended to move forward with submersible pumps instead of self-priming pumps, which also required work on the wet well slab to accommodate the change. Also, there was a power supply study that was required, and there will be materials tested necessary during construction.
So this is, all right, so we have that general discussion. Is there a motion on this item for the rate?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Okay, we have a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a second, Councilman Kinsey. Mr. Kelty, can you tell the public, educate me, the difference between submersible pumps, I understand what submersible means, but submersible pumps instead of self-priming pumps?
Actually, I asked Mr. Joe Barber to come up.
Thanks, sir. The first words are going to be, it's better, right?
That's right. Thank you, Mayor and Council. So the big difference that you'll notice is that the self-priming pumps sit on top of the slab. You see the pump and the motor up there. When it kicks on, you hear it. The submersible pumps, the pump and the motor are down in the water inside the wet well. When they turn on, you barely hear it. So it is nice from a public's perspective, these lift stations are very close to homes. So going to submersible really reduces the noise.
With this amendment, if the work is being done and with the submersible pumps, what are people within the vicinity or that are served by those lift stations going to see?
So currently, there's three lift stations. Right now, they'll see almost everything getting taken off of them. The wet well, which is where the pumps will go down into, is going to get coated, relined. There'll be a new slab on top, new electrical equipment, and a new fence put up around all three.
Is it going to help serve the system?
Absolutely.
That's the question.
Keeps it moving.
Keeps it moving.
Keeps it moving.
I assume there will be portable IS pumps.
Yes, and actually, yeah, lift station 3, that pump is in operation right now.
Council, do you have any other questions? If not, I'll call a question. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Motion carried. Thank you, sir. Why don't you hold on 1 second to step back. Item number 9 is consideration of possible action approving task number 22. The freezing nickels for the copper and lead project phase 1.
So this is another unfunded federal mandate that cities are being required to comply with. It has to do with lead and copper pipes in people's homes that we have to document and encourage. We have to develop an assessment. This assessment report is required by October 16, 2024. And freezing nickels would help us prepare that. With that report, with following objectives to assess availability and content of the records required for creating service line material inventory, create initial inventory based on 2 primary record sources, existing account records and county parcel data, develop data collection tool for meter visual inspections and a standard operating procedure to enable the city to begin identification of service line materials within the meter box. Develop compliance schedule and planning level budget to come into compliance with LCRR requirements, and support the city in applying for funding through the Texas Development Water Development Board. Again, this is a mandate, a required report that has to be put together. It is an expensive proposition of $70,000, but we actually did explore other options. That's an idea in regard to this, moving forward with this. But I would make council aware that this is the first phase of this initiative.
Okay, so before we go into further discussion from council, is there a motion one way or the other in regards to agenda item number 9?
I'll make a motion to approve item number 9.
Thank you. Councilman Payne, is there a second?
Second.
We have a second from Councilman Pena. Council, any questions for Mr. Kelly? I have a question. Is this part of, is this something that we have budgeted, or is this something that we're going to have to find?
My heartbeat just went out.
Molly, where is the defibrillator? Pretty good, not for this one.
There it is.
It's right outside the door.
Right? And it's not budgeted. So we are going to have to find the funds. The budget is going to be paid for out of water sewer funds. Unless after I go through and look at some of the bond money, we need to get that money to make the projects that we have obligated and how much they are. So it could be bond funds, but most likely it's going to be a water sewer fund.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Council, have any questions? Guys, we'll show.
Would that affect anything, or what, I know that what is it that we're looking to cut here?
Actually, we can't in the water sewer fund. There's nothing that we can cut because, as you know, we went through and we adjusted the water sewer rate to account for the increase in the BWA rates. It'll just have to come out of fund balance.
Unless by some miracle our operating our reserve, excuse me, operating what's it called, the
operating loss.
No, BWA. The only repair and maintenance.
Repair and maintenance.
So we're looking at the general fund?
Water sewer fund.
Water sewer fund?
Yes.
Come from water and sewer reserves.
Okay, okay.
Water sewer fund.
Gotcha.
All right, all opposed. Motion carried 4-0. Item number 10, consideration of possible action on resolution number 2023-2779. Supporting the same general funding for levy improvements. Mr. Clark, I believe, item number 10.
Carl Clark, for himself, just one quick question on this.
just a resolution to send to the state. This is not something that the city would be encumbered with just because the GLO didn't give their portion that they agreed to. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Ms. Anderson? Number 11. I'll call the question. Does council have any other questions on this? I thought there was a motion. If there hadn't been a motion, yeah, no, maybe there hasn't. Over liable. Is there a motion to approve?
I'll make it.
I'll call the council opinion.
He'll second.
Yes.
You know,
we're saying we won't have discussion. But I'll second it. I'll second it. So we get a discussion now. Go ahead, sir.
Thanks for saying that. I was going to say. I was just going through the state GLO funding and levy improvements. And I was thinking about how the Corps of Engineers have come out here at the last meeting. And they've been doing a round of meetings and information sharing sessions here. And I'm just curious if you're fully aware that the right hand knows what the left hand is doing as it relates to GLO and the Corps of Engineers as we move to act on this particular resolution.
So in regard to this particular project, the federal government has funded this to the tune of about $700 million, and they entered into an agreement with the Alaska Range District for a match that required them to come up with $246 million. At the time, they had a memorandum of understanding, I believe it was, with GLO. The GLO was going to provide that match. However, GLO later came back and appropriated $20 million as part of our local match. So that for the project to move forward, would require the GLO to come up with that $226 million balance. And so what they are doing is seeking support from all the cities and all of the schools and all of the government entities with similar types of resolutions and letters of support from industry regarding the importance of this project to get the legislature to go ahead and appropriate the remaining $226 million.
Thank you. That clarifies it for me.
Thank you. Okay. I'll call the question. All those in favor? Number 10, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed? Thank you, gentlemen. 4-0 unanimous. Item number 11, consideration of possible action approving resolution number 2023-2780 for vehicle and equipment and repair maintenance policy cap. This is it.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. This policy formalizes procedures for repair and maintenance of vehicles and equipment. It is the policy of the City of Freeport to keep all vehicles and equipment in good, safe, and working condition in order to effectively and efficiently complete the job tasks and ensure the safety of employees and others. The City is now required to have a policy for repairs and maintenance of vehicles and equipment from applying for various grants. This policy is formalized as what the City is currently doing. It came into question that Chief Motley has a grant that we have, we're working on it, and they asked us for a vehicle and equipment maintenance program. So it is needed for that. It's also been asked for when I was applying for different generator grants, because we have one of these policies. So this just helps us to apply for grants, because we have it in place, and it gives us more points when we apply for grants.
Do you have it going over now? Okay. So understanding that at this time, before we have discussion, is there a motion?
I'll second the chair's motion.
So we have a motion, and I heard something from Councilman White too. I had a motion from Councilman Kane and a second from Councilman Pena to approve discussion. Ms. Ezell, if you will look, and you got Pena with you there? Perfect. On the first paragraph, paragraph under the one second sentence. Put there to complete a work order, and then we need to put in form. That will be consistent with everywhere else. And then under procedure, section C, to show everybody and on the record, and my wife's not watching, that I'm not a sexist. C, the completed work order form will then be given to his. Probably, I think we need to say there. And then on E, or the, that's fine. Assuming it's still a person, not replaced by AI. E, the last sentence, if they determine. On F, before the department head supervisor will verify the funding before they give mechanic permission. They. And then item H, the average work hours. And then I think it's good out of that. Thank you. Council, any further questions on this?
Does that just keep a, for you, does that just keep records of work orders?
It's for plants.
Oh, for
plants. It's department to keep the work orders, but when it comes time to, I look at it this way, the hours, work hours and stuff, and that comes in when somebody's asking for a new vehicle and stuff. We can submit how many hours it's been worked on, and it helps us document on the vehicle why it needs to be replaced. And it just gives us more detail when we're trying to replace the vehicles and age equipment.
What if, I guess on the surplus, when we have equipment there, there's people want to ask for that documentation. I guess they would,
yeah,
they would get all
they
that documentation.
That documentation when it's up for auction, we'll have that documentation and then ask for it.
Okay.
And also, good question, Joshua. Also, I think that if you know we have somebody that's perennially not turning in something with their truck, we're trying to do preventative maintenance so we can keep the fleet. That's your fleet working is optimal as well. Any further questions? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Leach, you came in a little bit late for general comments, but I know you got a general comment on something that's in executive session, so if you'd like to speak now, please do so. Did I say that right?
Yes.
Thank you.
William Leach, 216 West Park. It's come to my attention that the city council is considering a piece of property that is on the east side of the Arcadia establishment. They're considering giving that away to bring in another dollar store. I'm opposed to that. My understanding was that land back there was originally designated to be parking area. Then the city, some years ago, took out 50% of the parking on West and East Park. But that land was supposed to be there as overflow parking, which should have and was slated to be developed as a parking area. I don't think that we should give it away, one. And I also don't believe that we need another dollar store in that immediate vicinity. I think we have three of them reported this time, as well as a couple of secondhand stores. I think that's probably enough. I think we need to come up with better use for that property. The downtown area, it's always been the goal to redevelop the downtown area, get some more businesses and such in there. And should that come to pass, we don't have enough parking down there. People are not going to walk blocks to go to a little store, do a little shopping. Parking needs to be close by.
Thank you, sir. Next, ladies and gentlemen, we'll go into the work session. And at this time, I just really have one thing to say. This Saturday,
Chief Motley, what time? 9 or 10? I believe it's 9, so you're about as right on like I am. But at the Brazos Ford High School Auditorium, there will be a meeting with departments from the federal government in regards to the release and fire that occurred at Freeport LNG. And I invite all to come. There'll be some comments from certain departments within the federal government, but there'll also be a time for questions. And yes, sir, Chief.
9 a.m. to 11 a.m.
At Brazos Ford High School Auditorium, the the John McGee Auditorium. There was a Carrie McGee, but John McGee. Auditorium from 9 to 11. Come early, come often, I'll be interested. So, with that, Councilman Pinion.
Yes, Mayor. Yeah, before we go into the executive session, I wanted to make a motion to invite the city manager and his buds to executive session. Make that motion.
Is that part of your comments and announcements? Because that's what we're on.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yeah, it's okay.
I have myself on this, but I do have some comments.
Thank you, sir.
So, you know, is that a leave? And Michael or Jacob? All right. Bear with me. I have a sore throat here. Mr. Rollerson, thank you for coming out. I think he's left here. But Mr. Kelty, I'd like to get copies of those police reports, if there was any made, in regards to the issue that Mr. Rollerson brought up, number one. Number two, Ms. Carla Clark had some outstanding information requests. And I'll call someone at Ms. Kelty, or actually Ms. Clark. Can you please send an email to City Council listing what outstanding requests are still outstanding? Number three is Cynthia Stewart. Thank you for your comments. I want to respond to your comments to say I can assure you that there are goodwill efforts. She's left. That there are goodwill efforts between council. Don't believe everything you read in the local headlines. You be the judge. Don't let one person's printed version of disparaging and biased articles fool you. That's why we have the Facebook live feeds, and everybody's always welcome to attend. Freeport is beautiful and has every right to be, and has every reason to be proud. We have been going through some growing pains that have made great strides in transparency and accountability, that I can assure you. And what we will get through days, we have more to do. Accountability is never fun, but we must make the tough decisions with your true interests at heart. And that includes replacing staff, just as it's true for public figures. Another comment here, I'll keep this one general here. I would like to remind all residents that all public figures, excuse me, all elected public figures are held to a different standard. That includes anyone that has declared their political ambitions and candidacy. As a candidate, one is allowed to run a campaign of three varieties. One, new ideas and solutions. Or two, a negative campaign. Or three, an attack campaign against whoever you personally dislike. And I think the public can tell the difference. That said, if you have any questions for the city attorney, like Mr. Reyna did, I would recommend taking those questions and have them directed to the city hall first versus bringing them unsubstantiated. Versus bringing unsubstantiated accusations. Excuse me. That said, I went to the lengths to educate myself on the rules. I recommend all candidates educate themselves of the rules too. And for the record, the issue, the topic of the Dollar General was actually cleared by Mr. Olson's, by Olson's municipal expert, Mr. Tommy here, and was witness by all accounts. And the very next day, I went another step to have a phone call with Mr. David Olson, who happens to have his name on the wall of the firm. And he himself cleared my ability to express or to share that information. If you have any questions as to what the legal grounds of those reasons were, I will request that you go ahead and make a call to their offices. But I can tell you, and the reason for my disclosure was for transparency, but mostly to avoid a backroom fast tracking of public property, aka public equity, aka public assets. So I encourage any person or candidate to put the public's input first and not just try to fast track a business transaction they either don't understand or have not discussed with residents or simply wanting to put a feather in their cap with no regard to the boards, the Main Street Board, the input of the city's strategic plan, and for that matter, they have no coherent version of their own. That's all I have, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Kane.
Mayor, what a beautiful weekend it was in Freeport.
It was great.
Coming up soon, we should be having another heavy trash day for the city, the citywide cleanup. If we manage to get three or four weekends like this in a row, we're going to be needing that. So I would strongly suggest that we go ahead and pick a day, start advertising it. That way, hopefully, we don't have citizens cleaning up and just throwing it outside. Hopefully, we can get enough advertisement and get in front of it enough to where citizens can try to coordinate cleaning out their debris along with it. Also, as far as cleaning up our debris, corner of 8th and Dixie, we have a house that caught on fire several months ago. Where do we stand on getting that thing taken care of?
We're actually scheduled on Friday to do a warrant inspection to take that before the damage occurs. The owner had already pulled the demolition permit, but it expired and he didn't demolish, so he said he's going to have to do it.
Are we going to pay for it?
Typically, there's even 30, 60, or 90 days to do the demolition, and we've been about 60 or 70% at this rate.
About 75%. The citizens have been very
cooperative. My concern, not only is it an eyesore, but the roof is slowly but surely falling further and further. It could become some dangerous before long. Right across the street from that house, there is a mountain of tore up concrete, which I'm not sure if it came from the road or the sidewalks or what have you. There's
streets.
Was it from the streets?
Yeah, it was from 7th.
And quite often in driving by, we see kids out there playing on it. Somebody's going to get hurt. We need to get that out of there, whoever is responsible for it.
And that's one. Near 8th and Dixie?
8th and Dixie. That's all I've got, Mayor.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Councilman Wright?
Mr. Kelty, is there an update on the lighting project, the lighting plan? I know you gave something last time.
Actually, we have been getting, the response from Centerpoint. And Laura said, before the city hall come over here, that started tomorrow, 6 weeks, they will have the lights installed. They've given us 6 weeks from the approval, which we now have all the maps, and so that 6 week time period should start tomorrow. Might be done sooner than that, some of them definitely. You'll start to see progress probably in the next 30 days.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, April, I guess.
For it to be completed, yes.
Yeah, April. All right, very good. Do we got any information on the Starbucks, on the completion date? I just...
Six months
for the completion?
Okay, so that's started or from now?
From now.
Now?
Counting weather delays.
They've been moving really pretty quickly.
Yes, I do see.
That surprised me. I was thinking it was going to be March or April.
Yeah, it's kind of a long...
Well, they didn't need internet.
You have an update on that on the internet?
it's kind of funny because in fact I called the gentleman from AT&T last Tuesday to get an update. He said, well, they got City Hall up and so I'm sorry, sir, but City Hall is still down. I believe City Hall is up as of today. All of dispatch is running. I know that I've gotten some connectivity at my house from an internet standpoint, but I know that they are still working. And they had originally given us a 2-week time period, which would be through Thursday next week. But I know they've had a lot of crews working. You see the cars lined up on 2nd Street every morning.
Mr. Kelly, I did a site visit and the contractors that were there, they told me kind of, apologetically, that they were doing their best, but they could expect to be had to go unfixed after the Super Bowl. So everybody went and made all the Super Bowl plans. True story.
They had 9,500 areas that they had to match that were not called for coordinating, so several pipes damaged.
Did a good job.
Mr. Kelty, maybe for the next council meeting, I was talking with other council members from other cities, and maybe you could tell us something about your goals as a city manager for, you know, within the next quarter, right? What is it that you want that we're looking at? You know, kind of make it seem like we're progressing. We are progressing. We definitely are, but maybe now, or you can, you know, talk about streets, any changes, big changes that we see. That's something I think you should share.
Every second meeting of the month, there's an opinion packet. There's an update of all of the projects that are going on the status of those. So I will pull that out and actually discuss that at the next time.
Yeah, thank you. That's it.
I waited for AT&T from 8 to 12. Because the online service said, well, it's, you know, we can't fix it, rebooting it, so we have to come to you, and it's fine. It never came. So then I find out from my neighbor, because I thought it was just me, that he was out as well, and he's a deputy sheriff, and went down there and found out that somebody had cut through 6 major lines of the fiber optic service. But I will say on Broad Street, it is working. I don't know about 2nd Street because my parents don't even know what the internet is. And they're better off for it. Mr. Kelly, do you have any announcements or comments?
Yes, just one of the things I wanted to remind folks that Mr. Dillon at the museum has put together an incredible exhibit. We've gotten already a lot of accolades for that. The exhibit will run through March 4th or 4th. So I encourage all of you to get down there and check that out. I will also say that the city audit is progressing extremely well and rapidly. Where in the past it hasn't been completed until April, May, or even as late as July. Our goal is to have that presented by March, and it will be as long as we had our auditors sent council out a questionnaire if they need to get that before they can wrap that up. So if you all have that questionnaire, please get it filled out and get submitted back to Lindy Penn.
When did that get emailed out, Kathy? The questionnaire, I don't know if I've seen it. Do you think it was sent already?
It was sent already.
Oh.
They have yours.
Okay, well, that's even worse.
They have yours.
Yeah. All right, and let's make sure we remind Jerry. Any other updates from the current infrastructure or department heads?
No, sir.
Okay. With that, we now have executive session regarding A, deliberations about real property, East End property swap with the ISE for Ordinance property and river property used for high school hall diamonds. B, consultation with attorney potential litigation, Veolia contract, Motel 6, investigation of Boys and Girls Club. Item C, economic development project, Bluebird, in accordance with Texas Government Code annotated, Chapter 551, Sections 551.071, and 551.073, and 551.087. Mr. Pena, I understand you have a motion, sir.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. I'd like to make a motion to invite City Manager and City Secretary to the executive session.
We have a motion to invite the Mr. Kelty and Ms. Wells into.
Yes, sir.
I will do that on a separate motion, sir. Into executive session. Is there a second?
A second.
Thank you, sir. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
So let me get this straight. Y'all are not allowing Mr. Kelty into the executive session.
Correct, sir.
All right. Well, we may just have to break the rules. And he's assuming that I think that's absolutely asinine since he's our city manager. But we go 2 steps forward and we take 5 steps back. Okay. So we have that motion. I make a motion to include Mr. Kelty into executive session without Ms. Wells. Is there a second on that?
I'll make that second.
Thank you, sir. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
Nay.
Nay and nay. I promise my wife I was going to be good tonight, being my first night back, and I am going to. Third comment, again, you're not going to get anything from me tonight. But is there a motion to include Mr. Johnson from the EDC in the executive session? I make that motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor say aye.
Is Mr. Johnson present?
Yes.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. All those opposed? Motion carried. Thank you. Ms. Wells, you are excused. Ms. Kelty, for now, you are excused. Ladies and gentlemen, you are excused.
Going on executive session, folks. I'm going to go ahead and finish my live. And then if we have any resulting action, I'll come back. If anything, yeah, I'll just come back right after. So that's it. Peace out, y'all.